to folks getting a Christmas puppy, what's the first thing they should do when they bring the puppy, when the dog home?
Oh, Al, don't get one. Don't get one. Don't get a Christmas puppy.
I knew that answer.
The only thing you should buy in December is probably a car. Because it's probably the end of the year. You could probably get a good deal. Maybe you can't. Maybe that's just in my imagination. But I would imagine people want to get rid of the model year and they want their sales to go up. Mm. Not a dog. Nobody should be buying a dog for Christmas. If you do, you ask the question in January. No one's allowed to ask a Christmas puppy question up until January 1st. January 1st, you can ask a puppy question. Before that, my recommendation is don't get one. Next.
Gross.
Hey guys, how are you? Welcome to the show. Let's open this up, get this closer. Hey everybody, how are you doing? What's today? Monday?
I don't know. It's weird for me. I look over here and we're all slanted. Do you always put your computer there?
I'm always looking at my computer because I'm using the video camera that's on that.
I think you always put your computer
like that. I always put my computer crooked.
No, you put it like that.
No, I do not. I never do it like that. I always do it facing me all the time. And yours is slanted too, facing you. Hey, everybody. How are you? It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, and this is Linda. How's it going, Linda?
Fantastic.
Right. With your fake smile. Okay, great. Here we go. We're going to ask questions. You're going to ask questions. Linda's going to ask the questions. You're going to type in the questions. Linda's going to ask the questions. I'm going to give the answers. If you don't know who I am, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. I've got a training center up in Providence, Rhode Island. I personally tour the world doing dog training seminars. I specialize in stopping unwanted behaviors. That's pretty much my gig. At the training center, obviously, we'll train your dog how to do all its obedience commands, but our expertise is stopping stuff you don't want, primarily aggression, a lot of high-level anxiety, massive leash reactivity, and we do some minor stuff too, crate nonsense and mouthing and, you know, barking and pulling and all that stuff. But we work with some pretty dangerous dogs. But my knowledge base is based on just about everything you need as far as dog-related when it comes to behavior. The more serious the behavior, the easier it is for me to stop. A lot of what we talk about on the show, this Q&A show, I'm doing three of these a week. It's like the punishment tour. It's like, punish it for this. This is how you punish. Everyone needs to learn how to properly punish their dogs. If you're not familiar with the term punishment, the only way to stop an unwanted behavior is through punishment. There's a right way to do it and a wrong way to do it. Believe it or not, you're not yelling and screaming at the dog. Like, we don't yell and scream at dogs. If I hear anybody in my place of business yelling and screaming, something's wrong. The place is on fire. There's something is wrong. There's no need for that at all. You're supposed to be calm the whole time. That's why we love training tools, because they help leverage your power. So you don't have to be physically powerful to correct a dog. And let's get going right to the show. There's a little button down at the bottom there. Little button is the dollar sign. If you hit that, dollar, dollar, make us holler. You can actually throw a little bit of cash our way. It's called a super chat. It's actually a feature that YouTube Live offers, and it goes right up into the top of the queue. So we get your question answered right away. Okay, Linda, let's start right at the top with
Hungry Animal Foundation.
Thanks.
Hey, Jeff and lovely assistant. Hope everyone is doing well on your end. So I am Mrs. Gellman.
This lovely assistant for tonight is my wife, Linda. All right. So,
or Mrs. Gellman.
Or if you call her, you will address her as Mrs. Gellman, please.
I think that's what I'm going to go around saying from now on. I'm Mrs. Gellman.
Really?
Yeah.
You really want to be Mrs. Gellman?
Not really.
I know. I wouldn't do that. This is Linda.
I don't like that name either.
Really?
Never liked my name.
Then change your name. You can do what you want. You're an adult. You can do whatever you want to do.
No. My aunt did that.
What do you want your name to be?
People. I don't know.
Okay, well, come up with a name. All right, we're doing great. Next.
How about Mrs. Gellman? Angela, I'm excited for a great show.
As I am.
So are we. Also, we recently inherited a hamster. My husband thinks we should introduce her and my schnauzer beagle. LOL, can you say disaster?
So...
we have a hamster.
You obviously... like married your husband not because of what's between his ears, right?
That's not nice.
He's a really good-looking guy with maybe a big penis. I mean, like, come on now, really? What's the man thinking? Come on, tell him no. That's not allowed.
Our dogs play with the hamster.
How many times have our dogs ever played with a live hamster?
Never.
Right.
They never will.
Right. Next.
Mario, am I the only one getting confused by the show numbers? The reminder says Q&A 481, but I was just listening to Q&A 482.
So, Mario, maybe. I just went through all of our videos for the last, I don't know, month.
Yeah, are you sure you weren't listening to 480?
Yeah, but I don't see a 482 anywhere. So I went back to 477 and I stopped. So unless I grossly got it wrong, which is I've been known to do, but this is 480. Now I'm confused. This is 481. Next.
Your chair is squeaky.
Yep.
Steve. 8-month-old nose downstay, layered with Dogtra e-collar, stays down until I leave the room and freezes instead of laying back down. When I correct as he's getting up. Huh?
Okay.
Okay, not sure if I'm correcting too high or not enough. His working level is 15 to 20. Also, will you use a bonker for this correction?
No, I wouldn't use a bonker right now. You have to properly punish teach your dog what a punishment is, which always sounds crazy. If your dog is counter surfing and you have the collar up at the highest level and you wait till the dog gets up on the counter and then you correct it extremely high and the dog screams and goes flying off the counter and runs away, you don't really need to explain to your dog like what's going on. The counter is hot. Stay away from the damn counter. But when it comes to obedience stuff, you actually have to train your dog what the correction is. So at the beginning of your training, when you're doing is you're saying no, correction, but now you have to guide your dog back into a down or a sit or on the place. Because the remote is not, it's not directional. So you still have to teach the dog. Then it gets it. So the last thing I want people doing for obedience is just pushing buttons. Next.
Melissa says, hi.
Hey, Melissa, how are you? Thank you.
Tony. They are slanted like the photos, LOL.
Exactly, Tony. The numbers on the show.
Ah,
right. Yeah. Right. Or our laptop, more my laptop.
Right.
Did you say it was crooked? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Milligan Valley. Hey, Jeff, I'm thinking of switching my Malinois over to raw. Do you have any tips or is there a resource I could go to so I can learn how to properly make the transition for
him? Yeah, go to pet.nutrition on Instagram. I don't know their official name, but go to pet.nutrition on Instagram. Great resource. Next.
Do it yourself said, no, Jeff, you ask the questions. We give the answers.
Actually, most of my super fans probably can give the answers and you guys still keep coming back. And I love you for that.
This one's from Lou.
Hey, Lou.
I added a mini educator with healing our leash reactive GSD a week ago. Today, I upped the distraction and stim. He started looking a bit panicky. Am I moving him too fast?
Lou, you could be. Or the dog is just now panicking, which is fine. Stress is good. Stress is good. Now, I don't want to put my dog into distress, but stress is good. A little bit of anxiety is good. A little bit of fear is good. The world is not like this enclosed bubble where everything is going well, as you know, being a human, right? And hopefully you're doing some stuff out there with your life, and you'll know that. It's like, yeah, man, I get... Somebody asked the other day, it's like, when's the shit eating? Oh, Jamal, J-Canine Universe, I think he asked, so how long did you guys have to eat shit for? It's like, I still eat shit every day. And if you know what that is, it's a business term, meaning you're doing all the crappy stuff that you really shouldn't be doing, but you have to do as you should be doing to build a company and build a business. And once you stop eating shit, then you stop moving forward. Well, your dog is learning right now. It's only been 1 week. You could have gone too high, or now you're finally challenging your dog and it's struggling, which we see all the time with dogs that have never been challenged before. So let it play out a little bit. Next.
Got a top chat?
Top chat. David Smith top chat. Making dinner and dropped some kale. So threw it to Rocky. Surprised he loved it. Guess it's like grass. I'll throw a bit into the bowl. Love you. Kale is good. Kale, mm-hmm. you can give your dogs kale. You can give your dogs spinach. You can give your dogs broccoli. You can give your dogs
just not romaine.
Peas.
No romaine.
No, I'm sorry. You can eat romaine. Romaine is safe. I'm sorry. It's bullshit.
You know that chopped salad we ate tonight?
Yes.
That did have some romaine.
So,
in
Linda,
it.
Let me just, can I
and
just.
And now I have some issues.
Honey, you have gas every night. Listen, this is the thing. You and the CDC do not see eye to eye.
Me and the CDC personally?
Yeah. You don't see eye to eye.
Of course I don't.
We're an anti-vaccine family. Yes or no?
I don't like to talk about that because it's a very passionate
exactly
subject.
You should do a whole fucking show on it. What I'm saying is,
I shouldn't.
The CDC,
I'm not smart enough
but the CDC recommends that you vaccinate your children and you do the flu shot. We don't do the flu shot, and now the CDC all of a sudden says get rid of the romaine, and you're the first one to get rid of the romaine. So either listen to the CDC or you don't listen to the CDC. Next question. Mrs. Gellman says, "Don't feed your dogs the romaine." Next.
Russ. Hey, Russ.
Hey,
good
Russ.
Good evening, Jeff and Linda.
Hey, love
good
you, evening, Russ.
IMH Hunt. Hello, I have a lab pit mix that was given to me by my next door neighbor. He knows basic obedience. My neighbor had him from 8 weeks to about 9 months. Every time she comes over, he forgets everything and gets, I don't know, because the rest of the question
okay.
is not there.
Okay, next. We'll remember that.
David Smith. Hey, Jeff and Linda.
Hey, David.
Hey,
again.
David. Yeah. Tiffany, ever have a dog above your skill level?
Yeah, when I first started out, that's why I got bit a lot. Of course. No, I mean, when I first, I talk about this almost every
Wait
show.
Wait a minute. Let me interrupt for a second about his body didn't have any scars on it.
It was flawless like a god.
You had one scar because didn't you have a hernia operation?
Yes.
You had that one scar. His body was.
Abdominal hernia. Yep.
His body was. Okay. I'm not going to know. He's flawless.
Linda, can we just move on?
Anyway, it's not anymore.
Okay. Are you complaining?
No.
Okay.
I'm just saying like.
All right.
I got bit a few times.
Yeah, I've been bit plenty of times. This is the thing. When I first starting out, I worked with aggressive dogs and I shouldn't have been working with aggressive dogs. Absolutely. Now, like we're not, there's no dog out there that we can't handle. Now, are they going to get the level of expectation that is needed? No, not always. Why? They're dogs. Look at us as humans, right? Can every single person out there run a marathon, run 100 miles at once? No. Right? Can and all of us be like incredible physicians or surgeons? No. So there's always going to be limits, but I'm a family pet dog trainer. I stop unwanted behaviors and I train basic behaviors. Next.
Caitlin. Hi, Jeff. First time catching you live. Wondering when T3 launch will be in Rhode Island, debating whether I should go to California or wait. I asked on the AMA today too, because I wasn't sure I'd catch you tonight.
Okay. So should I wait to answer the AMA or you want to know tonight? Usually we do T3. I would recommend going out to California. It's really nice. But the T3 in Providence probably is going to be in June. I think we do it in June.
It'll be nice.
Next, yeah.
Becky. Hi, Jeff and Linda. Hope you both had a wonderful Thanksgiving with the family. We did have
a
nice
Thanksgiving. We had a great time. Leftovers were great. They're gone now. Everything's gone. All Thanksgiving stuff is gone.
I'm so glad. Sean. Ha.
Hey, Sean. Ha ha. Next.
Michelle. Hi, Jeff and Linda. Rescue puppy, 3-month pit cross. Had to sign up for precocious puppies training, mandatory for rescue. The only thing my puppy learned was, if I whine, the nice lady gives me treats.
Exactly. It's a joke. I don't even know the name of this place. I don't want to know the name of you put the name there. So guys, don't put names of places there. So this is the thing. It's like most puppy training places are terrible. And just to let you know, we food train dogs. There actually is a proper way to food train a dog. I rarely see anybody do it properly. I rarely see people do it properly. So that's how we work with all. You have a 12-week-old puppy. Your dog would come here. It would be all food training. It would learn with a clicker as a marker. And we wouldn't use treats. We would use the dog's daily food. But most people do it wrong. So next.
I found the rest of that IMH
oh, sure.
question. It just says, very excited. What could I do?
Oh, so this is the thing. I thought the dog gave you, your neighbor gave you your neighbor's dog. It looks like the dog is coming over to you every day to get training and then going back. So, hopefully there's some reciprocal thing there, or unless you're trying to get lots of experience and photos and videos.
I thought they took the dog over.
I don't know. All I'm saying is this. If it's not being reinforced at the owner's house, yeah, it's going to be Groundhog Day every day. Next.
Briarick. Jeff, could you walk us through a scenario where you would walk a leash reactive dog past another dog and what you would do?
Yeah, just listen to the show. I talk about it all the time. All the time. So what you're really asking is, how do I punish a leash reactive dog? Let's get right to the point. Because if you're asking, how would I walk a leash reactive dog? I would just walk the dog. I would just heel the dog past the dog. How do I stop the leash reactivity? That would be a separate question. So if you have a leash reactive dog, I talk about this on every single podcast, just to let you know. 3 times a week, I talk about this live, and I've got so much video archive on this. It's incredible, and I also show my work. So the first thing you do, if you have a leash reactive dog, is the beginning of the walk, you correct it high, just for looking, for scanning. So you get out of your car, you get out of your front door, you walk out of your training center, you walk whatever it is, and if your dog is even looking ahead or even nosing out there, you would bonk it. If anyone doesn't know what a bonker is, I just made a video on what a bonker is. Look it up. Do your work, guys. Do your work. All right. Do your work. So look up how to make a bonker and how to use a bonker. There's a video on it on my YouTube channel. So you would bonk the dog or correct high on the remote. Right out of the gate, before you even go on a walk. And so many people are going to have a struggle with that because the dog hasn't done anything. Well, the worst place to do the correction is when the dog is already being reactive. That's not dog training. You missed it. So you totally missed the opportunity. You correct, listen to the narrative. Your dog is leash reactive. You correct then. Then what you do is the first couple of times utilize space. But first, what you do is you don't walk the dog by any dog. And you make sure your dog has got a great heel, meaning it's not even looking at grass. It's looking like it's not even pushing any boundary at all. You tap that collar, it looks up at you. No wandering, no pulling, no nothing like that. Then, in a proper heel, you walk. And at the first sign that your dog is aroused, you correct it high again. That's how you do it. And you eliminate your problem 99.9% of the time. That's what you do. Next.
Michelle, he whined for 4 straight days after that foolishness. Is he too young for a bonker?
No, he's not too young for a bonker at all. But you can also properly food train your dog. Yeah. So I can't tell you, everyone's worried about remote collars messing dogs up. Bad positive trainers mess up dogs so bad. They're so full of misinformation. It's incredible. And they're not even talking about proper training protocols that are well-established training protocols. 90% of the work we do is reward-based training. We use markers. We use rewards. That's what we do. And they can't even get that right. They can't even get that right. Next.
Adrian says, hi, we have a young Dalmatian who gets overexcited when out on walks and will do anything to get to other dogs and people. Just wondering what we can do for this. Thank you.
So Adrian, you're brand new to my world. I've got 5,000 videos and 10,000 hours of audio or combined content. So what I want you to do is make sure you're using the proper tools. So you want to be walking your dog on a prong collar. Prong collars will make your life so much better. If your dog's on a harness, you're going to lose. If your dog's on a martingale, you're going to lose. Flat buckle collar, you're going to lose. Choke chain, slip lead, you're going to lose. Okay. So what I want you to do is at least start out with the proper tools. 4-foot leash. Teach your dog, introduce the collar to your dog. I've got a free video on that. How to fit the collar, size it, introduce it, and teach basic heeling technique. I've got free videos on all that stuff. Work on all that. Then take your dog on a proper walk. Also, what's happening at home? How much structure is at home? Is at home a free-for-all? Can the dog just break every rule in the book? And then you take it outside and it's supposed to behave, which is what a lot of people do. They let dogs do anything they want in the home. They're just chasing around the dog. They're chasing bad habits. And then when it's actually out of the house, it's out of the control. So make sure there's structure also in the home. What is going in and out of a kennel look like? Everybody should be paying attention to this response because this applies to everybody. What's going in and out of a crate look like? What's waiting in a threshold look like? And are you using lots of voice? Stop using so much voice when you train your dog. I've got a big mouth, but when I train dogs, I don't talk. I barely speak to a dog. It's all through implied stuff and leash handling. And what we're doing is we're keeping our dogs in a aroused state, which makes them anxious, creates whining, creates massive amounts of anxiety in our dogs. It's all created by us and reinforced by us. So that's how you start. That's how you start. Follow my content. Every video is applicable towards you. Every video. Next.
Lion's roar. With an e-collar, my lab won't react to it at all, not even an ear movement. I've slowly increased the intensity and it still doesn't work. I just got larger prongs, but it's still iffy. Any tips?
Sure. I don't know the brand of e-collar you have, and I don't know how the fit is. Fit is everything. Fit is everything. So if it's not super snug to the point where you can't move the box, so if you can take the box and if you can move it around, it's too loose. It has to be, the contacts have to be making contact with the dog's skin. We recommend dog trot or e-collar technologies. Sport dog and Garmin work, but we don't like to, but we can't adjust the levels enough on those to train the way we train. Where dog trot and e-collar technology, we can. Almost every other brand is crap. I would stay away from it. I would stay away from it. So you'll do that. That's going to be, I would check fit. If I went, the first thing I would do is check fit. Next.
This one's from, Ron. I have a 14-month-old GSD. Love him, but he is lunging and barking at dogs with a high-level correction.
Will a
high-level correction work best?
Okay,
like great. 80 or so.
Thanks. Sure. So, Ron, why did you have to tell me you love him? I'm going to call you on your stuff. Why did I need to know that information? It's like, God, Jeff, you're so aggressive. You're so combative. No. We have limited amount of characters that we can type. Someone's going to write F-U. It's like, is two enough, Jeff? So we have limited amount of characters. Why did I need to know you love him? Are you trying to justify that you want to correct him high? You don't have to say that to me. You don't have to say that to me. I'm trying to change the way. I'm not trying to get people to not love their dogs at all. I want people to start thinking more. And I want people to start thinking not as much with their heart and more with this when it comes to dog training. I know, believe it or not, this is actually a huge point. Almost everything I say is a huge point. And it's not from it based from ego. It's like, I want people to understand the reason why we're struggling with our dogs is because we're letting our hearts control our action. We have to be super careful about that. So don't necessarily go to an 80 because I don't know how you've trained the dog. So, but again, Ron, that thing I did when the person asked about how do I get my leash react, how I would walk a leash reactive dog, that's what I want you to do. Correct out of the gate before the dog is aroused. Once the dog is aroused, most likely 9 out of 10 times, people get the timing wrong and they're going to send their dog over. You'll send your dog even into more reactivity. Next.
Becky, I recently got a bunny and he is a great distraction when training my dog on duration place work.
Nice. Ronan was chasing rabbits the other day. I forgot my hat.
I'm sure he wants to play with them, right?
He was chasing rabbits the other day. Look what I got.
Stop.
Nice, huh? Nice. Bunnies are fun. Bunnies are great distractions. You ever seen the big ass bunnies? Big ass rabbits? They're fucking huge.
Yeah, they're giant rabbits.
They're giants. I'm not even talking about the humongous. I'm just talking about like a good sized rabbit. We have little tiny ones in the field across the street from us.
We have bunnies in this yard.
Yeah, I know we do.
They cohabitate with the rats.
Yeah, they do. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
That's disgusting.
Yep, I know. That's where the term rabbit came from. See, they used to be called those little things used to be called as bits. Their name was bits. And the rats started breeding with them and now they call them rabbits.
That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
Go.
It's not even funny. It's like nothing.
Next.
I have to live with this. Jillian.
Sorry. Go.
Hi, guys. My dog often goes onto what we use as place on his own.
Good.
He thinks I've put him there and doesn't leave until I break him. Should I do anything about that? Like tell him to go elsewhere?
No, that's fine. Don't worry about it. Just say break. Next.
Hungry Animal Foundation. Finally got a remote training collar. My dog already knew it was for her. She gets so excited when I put that collar on her because she knows how much freedom she has to go outside and potty.
Yeah. So dogs historically should like the remote collar. We absolutely have dogs that come into our training center that don't like it. But They also, we don't care because they've got some pretty unwanted behaviors. But ideally, if you have the opportunity to introduce the collar to your dog, you know, I would introduce the collar to your dog before you actually need it. So like right from the beginning. It's like, yeah, let's have some fun with this collar. Let's do some fun stuff. The collar means frisbee. The collar means fetch. The collar means trick training. The collar means swimming. The collar means, you know, eating dinner. Get the dog excited about it. And then when you start using it and training on it, it's just so much easier. A lot of times, though, you don't have the opportunity to because you have a dog that's got so many bad behaviors, you need help right now. Next.
Ron, I'm aware of timing for collar corrections, but is high level the best way to stop the nonsense?
Okay, so Ron, I'm not trying to avoid your question. The proper application of punishment is the best way to do it. So if high level means to your dog, yes. But again, do it way before the dog is reactive. Way before the dog's reactive. Next.
This one's from Liz. Hi, Jeff and Linda. Did Ronan catch the rabbit the other day when through fence and come when called nice?
No. So no, he didn't catch that rabbit and no, he didn't come back to me. And I showed it live on video. I just had to stop the video because he was actually close to the street. So Ronan went through the, someone cut a hole in the fence.
You told me.
Yeah. So, but I showed it. I showed him not responding to recall. So Ronan's not a dog I can call off a rabbit. He's not. I've never trained him on that. So shame on me for not having a remote collar on the dog. So that's where training falls apart on a lot of times. I barely work him on it. He's on the remote most of the time. There, it's an enclosed area. He never breaks through that fence, but he runs the fence line all the time. Someone put a hole in there recently. He climbed. He went right to the feet, found it, chased a rabbit out of the fenced in area. It's pretty scary stuff. So I want people to know, a lot of people are like, oh, when can I stop using my tools? Don't. For all the what ifs. Next.
Michelle. Hi, Jeff. How do you introduce e-collar to a dog that constantly whines in the crate? E-collar arrives tomorrow and bonker only escalates the whining, sometimes into barking.
That's one of those things where we put the e-collar on the dog, start using it right away. You're going to start introducing it with, it's no different than my seminars. If you come to one of my seminars, everybody knows they're going there to learn how to use a remote collar as well as how to punish their dog and how to stop unwanted behaviors. So you can have a remote collar on your dog. And most people say, I've never used it. I've been afraid to use it, but it's on my dog. I said, great, give me the handset. I said, check the fit. I look at the fit. I said, great. We shut the dogs up in the crate right away. They've never had a collar on before. Next.
Here's a good one. I ski Big Sky.
Yes.
I got it right. Hi, guys. I used to live in, I don't know how to say that, Enumclaw,
yep.
Washington,
yep.
About an hour from Seattle. Told my friends when your seminar is. Told them they needed to go, even the ones who don't have dogs, LOL.
Oh, awesome. Thanks. Yeah, it's in Redmond, so which is like, I mean, it's not Seattle. But people probably in Redmond take offense to it. People in Seattle are like, fuck them. They don't live in Seattle, but it's in Redmond. It's actually
isn't that a suburb of Seattle?
I don't know if it's a proper suburb. It's across the. It's a, like there's a big body of water.
I know because when we were in Seattle for
yes.
your old business,
yes,
we were in Redmond.
Oh. Yeah, we were, and we visited Seattle.
Yeah,
I know.
It's a nice city.
Yeah, it's a nice city.
Karen.
Yep.
Hi, Jeff and Linda.
Hey, how are you?
Pam, Christmas tree put up today. 6-month-old Andy, the troublemaker, was very interested in chewing and playing around it. First Christmas for him. Enter e-collar. Yikes, tree is hot. No more interest.
That's a great way to use a remote collar. Yep.
Be healed dog training. 14-week-old puppy came yesterday for a board and train.
Fun.
Not eating yet, which I've seen plenty before, but also... can't get her to drink any water. Hasn't had any water in over 24 hours. Any advice on this?
Yeah. I'd call the owner up immediately and maybe the dog needs to go back. I would check that dog for health. Mm-hmm. I would want to know if that dog is healthy or not. Yeah. That's highly unusual. Stress is one thing. 14-week-old puppy though, that puppy, like we get dogs that don't eat, but puppies, they'll eat. Not drinking water is not healthy for a dog that size. I'd call up the owners unless, you know, or get the dog to the vet. Yep. If the dog is definitely not drinking water in 24 hours and definitely not eating in 24 hours, I would get the dog to the vet. Next.
This one's from Denzel. Hi, Jeff and Linda. I've been using your content to help train some of my mom's rescue dogs. Mucho appreciated. She got a very skittish dog whom avoids everyone and hides. How can I help him? Thanks.
So believe it or not, this is the thing about the skittish, fearful dogs. A lot of it is compulsion-based. Compulsion meaning force, which goes against the heart part out there that everybody would want to do. It's like, well, you can't use food because the dog probably won't take food from you, right? So, and the dog, you can't pet the dog because it's possibly going to nip you. Not because it was abused, because physical touch freaks out a lot of dogs. So what do? Leash on the dog, tools on the dog. We want to get a remote collar on that dog as soon as possible. Which sounds, again, it's like, so you're shocking fearful dogs. Doesn't that sound horrific? But it's like, well, if we leave this dog to its own devices, it'd probably get hit by a car or run away and get lost or freak out and, you know, something will happen to it. It's like, no, we need that dog to know as quick as possible that running from us sucks and hanging out right next to us is really cool. So what you're doing is, yeah, you correct the dog for fleeing. You have to. If you don't, you will have a dog that runs away. You will have a dog that its natural reaction to any type of stress will be flight. And you cannot have that. It's too much of a risk. You need that dog to know you are the safest thing in the room. Next.
This one's from Al.
So tons of structure, consequences for unacceptable behavior, but massive amounts of structure. Micromanage that dog right now. Next.
All right. This one's from Al.
Hey, Al.
To folks getting a Christmas puppy, what's the first thing they should do when they bring the puppy, when the dog home?
Oh, Al, don't get one. Don't get one. Don't get a Christmas puppy.
I knew that answer.
The only thing you should buy in December is probably a car, because it's probably the end of the year. You could probably get a good deal. Maybe you can't. Maybe that's just in my imagination. But I would imagine people want to get rid of the model year and they want their sales to go up. Mm. Not a dog. Nobody should be buying a dog for Christmas. If you do, you ask the question in January. No one's allowed to ask a Christmas puppy question up until January 1st. January 1st, you can ask a puppy question. Before that, my recommendation is don't get one. Next.
Angela, do you recommend deer antlers?
Yeah, deer is fine. Moose is fine. Elk is fine. Next.
IMH Hunt said, hello again. I took the lab pit over.
Oh, you took it over, like as it, and you own the dog. Okay, cool. So document your work and massive amounts of structure. Next.
Sean asks, what are your thoughts on dog health insurance?
I've been thinking a lot about that lately. I have it on three of my dogs. So the three that are in the room right next to me. So Tex, Girl, and Kira have health insurance. I pay $152 a month for all three of them. All three of them combined. I deal with healthy paws. I've used it one big time when Girl had her surgery. It's about a $4,000 surgery. I think after the deductible, I forgot what the deductible was, but let's just say it was like $3,250 back. So I guess that's good. So I guess it's, but I have health insurance myself. My family plan is very expensive. We rarely use health insurance. But the time that we had to go for rabies vaccinations, because there was a bat in the house, and I wasn't going to pay for it anyway, but the insurance did cover it. But that was good, because that was $50,000. $10,000 to $12,000 a person for freaking rabies vaccination that's $200. Go figure. Anyway, so what's your, you know, I would ask the vet office, what insurance companies do your customers say is good? That's what I would do. Ask the vet what's the good ones. Next.
Karen, is it difficult to food train when the dog is fed raw only? I do give him freeze-dried liver, but he can only tolerate a few. Thanks.
It's more challenging, yes. But you can always reward the dog from a spoon. Just from a spoon or just from your hand with gloves. But a spoon, you can dip it in the spoon and give it to the dog. Or you can freeze-dry your own kibble. Make your own little like morsels, not just liver, but also do like chicken and beef and cut things into small pieces. Next.
Ron, Does walking a dog reactive dog behind a group of dogs to get the pack feeling going to work?
So this is the thing, Ron. Good, really good question, Ron. You got some good questions tonight. This is the thing. It's a magic trick. It's a sleight of hand. It's a sleight of hand, right? So I used to do pack walks because I owned a lot of dogs. I didn't want to go on 20 walks a day. I wanted to go on 2 walks a day. So it was a lot easier for me to walk 14 dogs at once. So what happens is they have the pack mentality. Yes. Now, if you're always going to walk your dogs in a pack, it works. But say you're a dog trainer and you walk your dog, then the owner walks it by itself, it doesn't transfer. It doesn't transfer. Or if it's your dog, what happens when you walk the dog by itself? It doesn't transfer. So we don't do pack walks anymore. Now, some board and play dogs will go on 2 or 3 dog walks together, but board and train dogs are all one dog at a time. Why? That's probably what the owner is going to have to do. So we want to make sure that we don't have any sleight of hand stuff. It's enough that we have got a skill set. You know what I mean? That's why we love our tools. We don't want the dog to be relying on our skill set. We want the dog to be reliable on the tools. It's a lot easier to teach an owner how to use the tool than how to have a natural instinct to handle the dog. That's why I'm like, no, you correct the dog hard out of the gate. So if you always have a pack available, yes, but you might not. So be careful about that. Next.
This one's from Tiffany. Have you ever had a leash reactive dog that came to your training center that you were unable to help? Also, I hear you talk about bonkers a lot. Do they work better for some dogs than others?
Leash reactivity, we absolutely have had some extremely challenging ones. I mean, we get dogs that are so leash reactive, if you stop them, they'll turn and try to go up the leash at you. Like, that's common. Or they'll try to bite your leg, or they'll try to bite your face because they have to use that energy somewhere. So leash reactivity, we've always been able to make it better. Are some dogs, quote unquote, perfect? The only way we'd know if they were 100% is wait till they die and then look backwards. That's not with us. That's with the owner. So there's no perfection out there. Like, dogs are always going to have a mistake once in a while. So I don't know if there's been a dog that's been so out of control. I mean, we haven't had anybody, a dog that's, we've been like, geez, there's nothing we can do. Put it that way. Next.
Lil Mama Mud. Hey, Jeff and Linda. Still mildly arse puckering cold up in Canada. Week 2 of no reactivity. Less stim needed on commands finally. You are both much loved. Waiting to buy a hoodie.
Awesome. Cool. Proud of you. Really, really
I'm
proud
waiting
of you.
For a hoodie too.
I know. Can't I know. Wait. I know. I'm sending one coffee cup screen print to one coffee cup file today, tonight after the show.
So we can get cups soon?
You'll be able to get a What Would Jeff Do coffee cup. Yes.
I want the thing for my phone, though.
Nobody's supposed to know about that. Oh. Next. Next. It's okay.
I thought you said something on here the other day.
Maybe I did. Maybe I thought that it went. Yeah, it's fine. Go.
Don't tell me anything. Hungry Animal Foundation. How can I tell if I have found a proper trainer? What are the questions I should ask the trainer to determine their qualifications?
Well, qualifications not meaning educational. Don't go there. That don't mean shit. I don't care. I don't care who somebody studied underneath and where they went to school. So what I would do is this. In 2018, coming up into 2019, if a dog trainer doesn't have videos up, don't hire them. I'm sorry. Don't hire them. Because there's no excuse. I've got a production studio right here. I have a production studio right here. So you can make simple videos and sophisticated videos in your pocket now. And if you don't, you're just lazy. It's just pure laziness. For any dog trainer not to have social media up, they're lazy. They're like, oh, well, I'm too busy training dogs. I'm like, we're busy training dogs too. But we're trying to help as many people as possible. That's why we have so much free content up there. But don't let them, what you don't want to do is don't let them bring over some, their own dog, like a Malinois or a Shepherd or a highly trained dog and show you what they're going to do. That doesn't help anybody. Like, so my dog, I can't tell you how many trainers out there, and this is not a, I don't talk about any specific trainer because I really don't give a shit. I got enough things to worry about right now. But the point being, I've seen so many trainers have these Malinois, these demo dogs, and I'm like, that's really cool. That's actually impressive. Like, that's really cool that your dog, that Malinois, can do all that stuff. But are you saying that my dog can do that too? So my nervous, fearful, shut down, aggressive dog is going to end up looking like the Malinois at the end of 3 weeks? Because if not, why are you showing me the Malinois? And how do you know that they, I can buy a demo dog for around $7,000. I've seen trainers sell their 5-year-old Malinois for $7,000 that knew 30 commands. I could buy them and I'll work them. It'll look pretty great, but I didn't train the dog. I can buy a sheep herding dog. I can buy a trick training dog. I can buy a world-class agility dog. That doesn't mean that I did the work though. So be careful about that. What you want to look for is first of all, you want to stay away from anyone that doesn't believe in punishment. I mean, now they might use the word correction. That's fine. Not a lot of folks will use punishment like I will use punishment, but it's all the same stuff. You want to stay away from anybody that's reward-based, 100% reward-based, or pure positive, or force-free. So stay away from force-free and stay away from positive. I'm talking about for pet dog trainers here, guys. But that's even for most stuff, though, like service dogs especially. They better not be trained on just rewards. A service dog better have been punished for non-compliance of a known behavior and for a dangerous behavior, or else it's not a reliable service dog. So in the same way, like, you know, working dogs. So you want to find somebody that shows their work, that will tell you how they're going to stop an unwanted behavior. Good question. Ask them how they stop jumping. Can you tell me how you stop jumping? How do you stop a dog from jumping? They should give you a very simple, plain answer that's easy for you to understand and not beat around the bush. That's a good question to ask. Next.
There's a message being held for review.
That's okay, though. We get a lot of messages.
Do you want to read that? Do you want to show it or hide it? You get to read it.
Oops. Go ahead. I'll find it.
I have it right here.
Oh, well.
Yeah, I guess you did something to it.
Yeah.
Jeff, thanks for complimenting my video that I posted on your Facebook page with me walking the 4 dogs. It really boosted my confidence and self-esteem. You're the man. Thanks, Gary J.
Oh, no problem, Gary.
That was being held.
Yeah, I don't know why that was held. I don't know. Maybe it was too long or something. Next.
Little Mama Mud going to be bringing a kitten into the home soon, so we'll see how he does with that. He is super small, animal friendly. Can we allow some friendly sniffing eventually?
That's good. There's a lot of variables there. There's a lot of variables. I don't know your dog. There's a lot of variables, so be careful.
Next.
Yeah. Next. Sorry. Next.
Tiffany, one more question regarding the bonker. Have you seen success with stopping reactivity long-term when using a bonker if other things didn't work?
Yeah, I use the bonker first. Go right to the bonker, right out of the gate. Next.
Lions Roar, yeah, with the fit, the collar can move. Thank you so much.
Awesome, start there.
Ron said, no, man, it was a question from before. Sorry.
That's okay, Ron. Ron, sometimes like the cadence is a little bit weird tonight. Next.
Becky, what company do you use for insuring your business, if you don't mind sharing? Trying to figure out if I need to be bonded as well as insured.
You should be bonded. I think it's a Rhode Island company. So it's a Rhode Island company, and I'm not sure the name of it. It's through my insurance agent. So it's business liability insurance through my whoever covers my business. My home. They got a business policy for me, but I'm not sure the name of it. I'm not sure, but you can call up your homeowner's insurance, call up your insurance broker, and ask anybody that does insurance, do you do business owner's insurance? Next.
Ron, I have work at 12 to 15.
Yeah, so 12 to 15, that's usually your working level. Some dogs is a punishment level. For reactivity, you probably have to go high. So if we have a dog on a 12 to 15 normally that we're working for reactivity, I might go to 30, 40, 50, 60 right out of the gate. Next.
Little Mama Mud, haha, rabbits. Here we got a weasel hiding dead mice in the truck engine. Nothing like a pile rolling out when driving away. Arctic hares are the size of cocker spaniels.
Yeah, there you go. Next.
Kiki, I use the pet convincer with my two dogs I'm training. My third dog is terrified of it. Can I counter condition this for a dog that isn't used on?
Yeah, that's the problem with the pet convincer. It hits every dog. The sound of it does. That's the downfall of it. That's what you got to be careful about. You use it to correct one dog. Like one of my dogs, Girl, can't stand it. If I say no to a dog, she goes, oh shit. I'm like, Girl, you know I'm not talking to you. That's the problem with it. Can you counter condition? Yeah, but then don't plan on ever using it on that dog. Next.
David, you should see some of the jackrabbits we have here in Arizona, right. Like kangaroos, right. LOL. Right. Oh, right. No. Yeah. Ron, I think you're our number one, and I have hundreds of hours of your vids. Love you guys.
Hey, Ron. How are you?
Toby, my dog doesn't sit when I put the treat over her head and move it back. How can I teach her to sit?
Well, keep it, Toby. So sits, not something I usually focus on. Number one, use leash. You use a little bit of leash guidance. Use leash guidance. So if you're just trying to do free shaping, I don't do free shaping. I don't train free shaping. So I don't know. I mean, I don't. That's not my technique for teaching sit. I don't do luring behaviors. So I use the food as a reward. So what I do is I use a marker reward training system. So I mark the behavior. And then I reward it afterwards. So you're doing more luring stuff, which is fine. That doesn't make it wrong. Luring is very effective, especially in puppies. But you can teach a dog, like all of our trick training is done with a lure system. So my obedience is done with more of like, this is where I want you, and then mark it, and then there's your reward. And I do that with leash pressure. Leash pressure and a little bit of hand guidance. Next.
Greg says no water for 24 hours. Wowzers.
Yeah, I get concerned because if it's a small breed dog, I get concerned, and if it's a young puppy, I get concerned. Next.
Lou, GSD 2 hyperbonded and has separation anxiety. Does long place but never relaxes. Does a few hours crate daily. Does not relax. Will eat bed if left inside. Suggestions.
So get rid of the bed. Number one. Because or else you'll end up with a dead dog or an expensive emergency room visit and possibly surgery. Number two, use the remote collar. You can use the remote collar to diffuse stress. And it's not because, and some people say, oh, so you want to shut down the dog? No, it's not shutting down the dog. You want to see a shutdown dog? Go to some animal shelters. You'll see a shutdown dog and the dog's got no electronics on their neck. You know, so what it is, it's imagine the remote collar being a big, huge arm that rests on the dog's shoulder and says, hey, and it goes, I need you to relax. It's incredible how well it works. Massive amounts of structure in the house work really, really well. Watch your tone of voice. No excited voices as well. Next.
Be healed dog training. Talking with owner and puppy at least is being bright, but I was thinking vet visit too.
Yeah, absolutely. So now we're going in the medical world and Rach, and I don't know anything about that. Next.
Blair, how do I structure a calm social interaction between my friend's dog and my dog? My friend's dog is an adult and is well-behaved. My dog is a puppy and leash reactive.
So Blair, it's too complicated to discuss on a free show in 30 seconds or less. Because I don't know anything about your dog. The other dog, other than what you gave me, I don't know anything about you, your dog training skills, or your friend's dog training skills, or how aware you are of the of signs the dogs are going to be possibly getting into a fight. I've had owners go, oh my God, my dog's about to fight. And I'm like, that's a play bow. And then I've got other dogs going, oh my God, my dog is so happy. I'm like, no, it's about to attack my dog. Like, so I've seen dramatic shifts in like knowledge spectrums. So I don't know. All I know is this, that you want it. The best thing to do is walk the dogs right now. Just go for structured walks right now. Get them to exist with each other. Don't worry about them interacting right now. Next.
Tiffany, I missed Ronan not recalling, but I have clients asking all the time when they can stop using their remote collar. I explain I still use it on my 12.7-year-old for that exact reason.
Right. Who the fuck says 12.7-year-old, Tiffany? Are you serious, Tiffany? How about most people say, almost 13 years old. And is that 12.7 or is that 12 years, 7 months? Because then technically it's not 0.7 because there's 12 months in a year. So which one is it? Next.
Tiffany, I also have healthy paws and I'm so thankful for it. Would have paid thousands of dollars out of pocket. Why now?
I know.
Do you have anything to say?
No. She has insurance. She's got insurance and she's thankful.
Yeah,
that's great. Awesome. It's good. Sorry. It's good. Next.
Why are you yelling?
I'm not yelling. Next.
I'm kidding. Ron, e-collar working at 12 to 15, going into socializing groups. Should I up the level and correct as I go in on a higher level? Any thoughts? Sorry for the wall of questions.
So, Ron, you should do a Skype, but this is what I want you, seriously, because you have a lot of questions. I don't mind answering questions. I don't want you going up high on your dog when it goes into a pack of dogs. Because there's more prep work you have to do. There's prep work you have to do. Because if your dog screams, what are those dogs going to do? I need to know what every dog is going to do. And I need to know what your dog is going to do. It's really, really important. So there's an art that now we're talking about the art of dog training and the art of dog handling. The last thing I want any owner to do is bring the reactive dog into a bunch of dogs. And if the dog misbehaves, to correct it high. Because I need to know about those dogs. There's so many variables. That's why we set it up at our training center. We work the dog through it. But the theory though is yes, you're going to have to do that at some point, but there's prep work you need to do for the dog first. Next.
Max Asina says, you were bit by a bat?
No, we were, the health department, there's a bat in the house. This is all craziness.
We don't know how it got in.
We don't know how it got in. It could have bitten somebody in their sleep. And I'm like, really?
It heals over in 10 minutes.
It's like, really?
You never know you get bit.
I know. And a kid did. Didn't a kid in Rhode Island die from? A
kid in Florida. Got scratched by a bat.
Yep. So anyway, so the health department wanted us to go to the hospital and get vaccinated. Next. That's why I wasn't going to pay for it.
Yeah. That was fun.
That would have been a homeowner's insurance issue if it came down to it. Next.
Ron, behind a pack? I don't know what that means.
Behind a pack. Again, you could, but get off the pack thing. Forget the pack thing. Train your dog just one-on-one, Ron. Forget the pack. One-on-one, get the dog to do well independently of others. Next.
Susie.
Hey, Susie.
Michelle, brother passed recently and I've inherited a 6-year-old Persian cat. Intro to my 3 dogs plus new puppy. Separated by gates for a week. Intro 1 dog at a time to smell each other, etc. Now all dogs and cat in the same room supervised. Any other advice? How will I know if they are ready to be unsupervised?
I would never leave 4 dogs with a cat unsupervised. I wouldn't leave 1 dog with a cat unsupervised. Never. I would never do it. I wouldn't leave 2 dogs together really unsupervised unless you knew everything about them. There's too many variables. You'll end up with a dead cat. You want to make sure that cat has first of all, I wouldn't leave 4 dogs unsupervised just in general. Like, why aren't they in crates?
It's 3 dogs.
3 dogs. Why aren't they in crates?
Oh, plus new puppy.
Yeah, right, that's what I mean. 4. So they should be in crates when you're not supervising them. So, but I wouldn't do that. I would make sure the cat had another room to go into. Next. That's just my professional advice, seeing too many dogs kill cats.
Ron says, got it.
Got it, Ron.
Michelle, in the same room supervised.
We already read that one.
Oh, okay. Marnie, cool dog. Hoodie. I know.
We're trying to.
Greg, let's get those coffee
cups going,
man.
I know.
Come on. Yep.
Oh, Pat threw us $4.99. Thanks, Pat.
Thanks, Pat. How's it going, Pat? Tiffany, your demo dog comment is so spot on, so good.
Yep.
Watering 50. Hi, Jeff. I'm not giving up following your advice last week, and it's been awesome. What can I add to structure besides most of the day in place? I do obedience, treadmill, crate, and short walks.
You're the one with 2 fighting dogs, I think. That's your structure. Again, you've been bit. The dogs have been bit. That's your structure. Without working with you one-on-one, I can't tell you anymore. And I'm not trying to hold anything back from you. I don't want two German shepherds, if I recall right, two German shepherds that have bit you, that you've gotten bit from, and that have fought with each other five times. It would be unethical for me to go any further. It would be unethical. Like this is intense work. This is intense work. Next. But I'm glad things are going well. It's only been 2 weeks. Try doing that for 6 months. 6 months. Next.
Megan, so glad you mentioned the demo dog thing. It took me a while to realize that shouldn't be my goal and wasn't a realistic goal at all.
No. God, no. God, no, not at all. Next.
Yazarina, way to calm him down is picking him up, and I feel like I am reinforcing his bad behavior.
You are. You're training a dog how to be neurotic. Stop picking up your dog. Unless it's like, has to go to the emergency room or it's getting attacked. Next.
Tammy, walked my GSD with a four-month-old golden, my dog giving the eyeball, breathing, and gait changes. Corrected on prong and had a great walk.
Awesome, Tammy. That's a good thing. Yep.
Hungry Animal Foundation, thank you for answering all my questions about dog trainers. I've had people telling me a bunch of shit that didn't match your advice.
Yeah. I mean, this is the most common thing. Find a certified dog trainer. Find one that's pure positive. Find one that like, fuck you. That's why we're in the mess that we're in. Now, if you just want to train your dog, if you want to train your dog how just to do some fun stuff, sure. But if you have a family pet and you actually want to get results, it's impossible. It can't be done. I've yet to see it. Show me the fucking video. I'm sorry. It's the biggest lie. It's the biggest scam going out there. And we train dogs with rewards. We use clickers. We use rewards. We use physical touch. We use play. We use textbook scientific methods. But not to stop an unwanted behavior. And what happens when the dog doesn't do what you want it to do? What, use higher value rewards? Work another 3 months on basic obedience? It's a scam to get more money from you. No, it's not going to work. People going to like, I can't tell you how many people have gone to like 30 reactive rover classes or three 12-week sessions, 36 weeks, and they still can't get their dog or like to do certain things. Basic stuff. Sure, some stuff is unattainable. But all this other stuff that you keep hearing from people, never get a dog trainer that would never use correction or fear or punishment. Well, maybe not to teach sit or down or place, but growling, biting, aggression, jumping, counter surfing, recall technically. You know, oh, recall training shows be fun until the dog doesn't come back. Now what do? Right? Next.
Rosemont Ave, how do I stop my dog from chewing the towel I have over her dog bed while in the crate?
Get rid of it. Why do you have a towel over your dog? Why do you have a towel there? Take it off. Get rid of it. You don't need to cover up your crates. I mean, we cover up our Chihuahua's crate because it's free. They're freezing their asses off.
At night.
Or what you do is this. I would get rid of it because if the dog swallows the towel, you're going to end up to a dead, you're going to wake up to a dead dog. You will wake up to a dead dog. Or you wake up with a dog that has got a blocked something and you'll have to go in for surgery. It'll cost you thousands of dollars. It's $3,200 in Rhode Island to cut open up a dog. $3,200.
That's if nothing goes wrong.
That's if nothing goes wrong. And historically, they have got to go in for a second surgery. So, or you can sit out there, sit with your dog. You set up a nanny cam and you have a remote power on your dog and you wait and you watch. And as soon as the dog reaches up to grab the towel, you punish it high. And the towel becomes hot. And now it sucks. But would you trust your dog sight unseen overnight in that situation? I wouldn't. I'd rather get rid of the towel. I'd rather just get rid of the towel. Next.
This one's from Michelle. What qualities do you look for when hiring training, kennel, and dog walking staff?
Nice people. Next.
Yazarino, my 2-year-old Ridgeback mix pants and shakes in his crate. How do I get him to calm down? High E collar correction just seems to make him Yelp, but no chance.
Yeah, I know it will. You don't have to go high. It's called fishing. It might be low. It might be lower numbers and then a little bit higher. And then you might be on continuous and then you might be on momentary. And you got to figure out the recipe. Also, your dog should be in a down with its head down. So you teach a double down, down and then head down. Next. Also, what kind of structure are you doing outside the crates? How much affection are you giving outside the crates? How much structure, how much affection, how much consequences? So if you give your dog all this freedom all around and everybody can tighten things up a little bit and then you put your dog in the crate, that's what you're going to struggle with. Next.
Tiffany, foster dog has an annoying licking habit, mostly licks carpets, rugs, etc. Anytime he's out of the crate, he eventually starts licking something obsessively. Should this behavior be corrected? Also, my nephew is at the ER right now getting rabies shots for potential bat bite as well. So ironic that you mentioned that on the show today.
Yep, I know. He's got to probably go back two more times.
Took us about almost a month to get all of them. I don't know. I lost count, but it took about a month.
I know.
It was terrible.
Yeah, so correct the licking unless you want your dog. Put it this way. If you want the licking to stop, you have to correct it. If you don't, you reinforce it. The lack of no is always yes. Next.
Michelle, Jeff, following up Lou's question, do you have a video showcasing the use of an e-collar calming down an anxious dog having trouble implementing this?
No, I don't think I do, but I talk about it all the time and I demo it at every one of my seminars. Every one of my seminars, I demo it because people can see it live right there. Next.
Hockey 13, Pit and Lab get overly excited when anyone comes to door, including us. How to stop it?
Through the proper application of punishment. So get a bonker. So Hockey 13, you're brand new to my world. Thank you. Welcome. Get a bonker, make a bonker. I've got a video on this. The video shows this actually, how to make it and then how to use it. And the how to use it, I show it throwing it at the door. You say no, whiz it at the door really, really hard. You try to hit the dogs. You're throwing a towel at your dog. Yes, you try to nail him. So next.
This one's from Lou. GSD seems collar smart already. Yeah. My husband called him when I was holding the remote. He saw it and then came to me instead. I didn't correct him. He looked confused. I hid the remote after that.
Well, you shouldn't have to hide the remote, but you want to role play that. You and your husband put your dog back on a leash and role play that exact scenario. The dog's not coming to the person with the remote. The dog should be underneath voice control. And when it's coming to the person that actually said the command. If anything, what I would do is I would play the reverse game on that dog and I would make sure whoever has the remote doesn't call the dog. I want that dog to listen to your voice. Next.
Tiffany, listen, when you have a large breed dog, every month counts. Sorry.
It's true. Next.
Ron, email for a Skype session.
Yeah. Go to my website. Guys, this is how I make a living is through, I actually talking about business advice today. And this is the last question of the show because,
it's been over an hour.
It's been over an hour. And Linda only does an hour, which is fine. It's Monday night. It's late anyway. It's late for everybody. So I did some business questions. I talked about a business idea that I came up with and I'm like, yeah, it's going to generate me another $50,000 of new revenue with a 90% profit margin, meaning it's only 10% cost. So, I was thinking about this, like, God, I never talk about making money on my show really that much. I think some people also forget. It's like, I got a business. So Skype is one of my businesses. And actually, yes, I make money through Skype. You can go to my website, Ron. Go to solidcaninetraining.com, solidcaninetraining.com. You go to the website and you just there's a Skype button. But also join my Patreon channel. You can join my Patreon channel on Patreon. It's as low as $5 a month. And people also do 15-minute and 30-minute Skypes with me. But most people end up doing an hour Skype with me and that's what they book. But that's actually what I do. So my company right now, we've got 10 employees, 17,000 square feet of space. So my monthly break even is really high. So we have to generate revenue, but I think a lot of people are used to me giving out so much free advice. So whenever I talk business, that might take people back, but actually I spend most of my day running the company and I spend a good part of my day figuring out how I can put out more free content though. How can I help more people? So I try to have a good mix of that. I was thinking about that tonight when I came up talking about that idea. So there's a $4.99 super chat. We got to grab that question. That's from Dog Works. There's no question underneath it. Just threw us $4.99. Thank you so much, Dog Works. Love you. All right, guys. What's tonight? What's the day of the week tonight? Today? Monday? Sorry, I don't have days of the week, guys. I go 7 days. When do I show? Wednesday? Wednesday, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Wednesday, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. All right. Take care.
Good night.
Good night, everybody.